All right, it's 6 o'clock, and we're here at Boost Power TV. I'm Alexi Sahagin, your host, and I'm here with Jimmy Biro, and we're here to talk tech. And we got some questions and answers that we're going to go over, and a little insight on a few hot topics. Last week we talked about some safety items, and a few weeks before we kind of dipped into that a little bit to stimulate you folks to think about some different angles of your safety and how you handle your boat. And tonight we're going to go over some questions that were written in that are, you know, pretty popular topics. You know, in the beginning of the show, we always like to go over what events are coming up. Again, I'll remind you that we have the Lake of the Ozarks shootout coming up at the end of August here. And that should be fun, where we see a lot of the high performance boats going for top speed and just a great event for people to visit each other and check out all the hot boats and power and people in the industry. It's really just a good time out there in Missouri. All right, Jimmy, so what do we got? What's our hot topic for the night tonight?
Well, the first one actually comes from a lady from Lake Mead, and of all things, she was asking about water separators. Apparently, she was looking in the engine compartment, her husband was back there, and she asked, what's that big old filter thing? And husband said, it's a water separator, and he seemed to only change it like once a year. She was like, well, how often should we do it? Is once a year good enough? Should we change it more often? Is, you know, what should they do?
All right, so we've talked about these filters in the past. This here is a Fram water separating fuel filter. Usually you see a little drain plug on the bottom. And there are several different style filters, you know, the MerCruiser spin-ons and some of the Ramco ones that are silver you see on Merc 1075s all the way up through 1350, 1550 engines. Fuel and water separators are really important. So to answer the question quickly, it separates fuel and water. Mm-hmm. Water usually settles at the bottom of the filter. Therefore, they put a drain at the bottom so you can basically unscrew this and inspect it. Most guys just change the filter, or they take it off, pour it into a jar, inspect it, and then put it back on either a new one or the existing. So we've all seen fuel in a jar. Here we have some pump gas. This is 91 octane pump fuel here in a jar, and it's pretty clear and it looks pretty good. But if you take water and put water into the jar, you can see the water separate. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to unscrew this lid for those of you that haven't really seen how this works, and hopefully we'll be able to give you a little insight on how the water actually makes its way into the fuel. So here we have the fuel, and then we put a little water in there. You see how it's fogged up, and now it's separating toward the bottom. You see that clearly, how it's getting down to the bottom, and now you can clearly see, it looks like two horizons. There's a water separated table, and that's this area here. I'm going to take my happy little chopstick here and show you. This is all water. This is the water table that collects in the bottom of the fuel filter. So again, inside the fuel filter, it's sitting right underneath here in this section, usually up to 1 inch inside the filter. So you want to make sure that's not in there. The other thing that's interesting about this little experiment or display, so to speak, is we have the jar, and if you shake the jar up, if you have ethanol-style fuels, you see how it's still separated? So it stays separated for quite some time. But if you have like an E85 or an ethanol fuel, you'll see that the fuel will stay mixed with the fuel, and it will not separate. So a lot of the high performance boats out there that run E85 and E98, those guys are the ones that have the most trouble immediately when water is introduced into the fuel system for two reasons. The water mixes with the ethanol and it looks just like cloudy. Here's a display of what it looks like. It just looks like cloudy, cloudy fuel. So like if this was just cloudy fuel, instead of it separating at the bottom, it's kind of mixed throughout the whole batch of the fuel. So you see an immediate decrease in performance because it's not separating at all. It's mixing with the fuel. It's more prone to fuel that has more alcohol in it. So like 15% ethanol in regular pump gas, obviously it's going to be worse in regular pump gas. It'll still separate, but just not as much. If you go into E85, because it has more percentage of alcohol, it will then mix with it and make it even worse. And as you move into regular alcohol around water, obviously that's probably one of the worst mixes that you can have. The other thing that's interesting about this that most people don't realize, because in our high performance marine industry, we don't use flex fuel sensors as often as we will be in the next 4 or 5 years. A flex fuel sensor, depending on what type, will actually false if it has water in the fuel. So it'll think that it's got a higher, you know, percentage of alcohol when it's really water and cause all kinds of havoc. So it's really, really important when you're running alcohol or ethanol to really keep those filters changed and make sure the fuel is in good order with no moisture.
Lexi, also, I've seen you have magnets on some of these filters. Do they ever put magnets on fuel filters?
You know, most of the time, no, because there's not much metal floating around in the fuel systems.
Okay.
But on the oil systems, you see them all the time, which we've explained previously, because there's always Babbitt and, you know, different small microparticles that are going around the oil. And, you know, at the end of the day, that dirt clogs up the filters, and then it blocks and makes them go into bypass. And we don't want them to bypass. So you've seen these little magnets, they go conveniently onto the filters. But like, again, this particular display here is oil. And if we've done this little trick before, this is just clear motor oil, and it has, you know, you can see there's a little bit of dirt and Babbitt. And
that's new motor oil, right?
This is brand new motor oil. We put a little bit of debris in there for the testing purposes. You see it in the bottom. And if you simply just hold the magnet on it and shake it right in front of your eyes here, which we've done before, a magnet will clean it all up in just a second. You can see how clear that is now. And all that material is sitting against the magnet. So it gives you a lot more life on your filters. And if you have more life on your filters, then your filter is not bypassing, putting unfiltered oil into the motor as the paper gets clogged. And at the end of the day, you'll have the better result of cleaner oil going through your system and having the maximum protection for your engine. So I just wanted to explain that the fuel thing is a big deal. I mean, here's another display of perfectly good pump gas with no water table in it. And then again, this is regular pump gas with a water table in the bottom. It basically, you're looking for that two horizons there. You can see there's a separation. So a lot of times we've gotten boats in here where we have an inch of water in the fuel filter, and we've deemed that the gas is contaminated. But what we do simply is we pump the fuel in a circle through a water trap. So if you suck the fuel out of one fuel tank and go all the way back into the same fuel tank or another catch tank, you'll see if you unscrew the filter that you've pulled X amount of water out of it. And you can actually treat the fuel and reuse it. Is it the best thing in the world to do? No, we like to see new fuel in a high-performance engine. It's not worth the risk. But can it be treated? The answer is yes. It can be treated, and you can get most of the contaminants out of regular pump gas. When it comes to E85 or E98 or any of those ethanol fuels, my recommendation is to get all of it out and dispose all of it. You can't unseparate it. It's very difficult, if possible at all. So that would be scientific talk, but it's pretty hard to get that stuff cleared out. So hopefully that answers that question a little bit more there.
Yeah. So our next question comes from a gentleman from Lake Piru, California, and he bought a Jetbo with a 1,000 horsepower engine, he says. So that's at least what the person he bought from says. And he wants to know how many hours, you know, before he has to rebuild or refresh the motor. The motor has about 620 hours on it, and he just wants to know, you know, at what point do you spend the time to rebuild? What is the difference between a rebuild and a refresh?
Well, this could go on for hours, the answer to this one. I mean, a rebuild, a refresh, a refurbish, you know, redo, tune-up. These are all based on what the engine or boat shop decides that their definition of it is. Is there really an industry standard? I would say in our high performance marine world, yes and no. I mean, A regular refresh or rebuild is basically, say, on a high performance, say, pick a Mercury 525, just an industry standard, you know, fleet motor. So if you take that thing, you know, one guy might change the rings, the bearings, and the valve springs and put it all back together and do nothing else, and that's his version of a rebuild. You know?
Yeah.
So the bad part about this is that one guy will call 10 places and get 10 different prices, but he's also getting 25 different processes that he's actually getting bid on. So it's really hard for a consumer to figure out what it is, what, you know, what is a rebuild? What are you getting?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, what, do they replace everything? I mean, even push rods? I mean, wouldn't
right? I mean, the right answer. Yeah, exactly. Push rods. I mean, do, at what point do you decide if your valve springs are worn out versus your push rods or your lifters? You know.
For me, if, while you're in there, I assume just do as much as you can.
Right.
You
know? And but see, that can turn into, well, while you're in there, let's just put a whole new motor in there.
Yeah.
You know. So it's like, where do you draw the line and what's necessary?
Yeah.
So my quick answer to that is take the motor apart and look at the integrity and the history of the computer on the engine and see how old is it? Is it a first generation engine? Has it ever been apart? Are the seals still on it? Do you trust that the seals aren't tampered with? You know, decide what it is. If it's a first generation rebuild, usually rings, bearings, valve springs, and valve job and all that is what most folks do. In our world, because we don't ever want to see it come back for something stupid, we change all the valves, all the springs, all the retainers, all the locks, all the keepers. The pistons get changed 90% of the time. Everything gets rebalanced. We just, it doesn't make sense not to spend the extra couple grand doing all that stuff. That's our version. Now, our version is also maybe more money than everybody else's, you know, and I understand. And, you know, maybe we're not good enough about explaining it. But the thing is, you can call a gas station and they'll tell you that it's $3,500 to rebuild a big block engine till you show up with it.
Yeah.
You know, and then you can go to shop A and they say, oh yeah, no problem. We can get that all done for $8,000.
Yeah.
And they just, you know, maybe change the rocker arms, you know?
Yeah.
Who knows what they do?
Yeah.
You have to actually see it with your own eyes or get some kind of proof. But usually what we do is we take it apart, we photo it, we send it to the client, and you know, that's a good question about the push rods. You guys have all seen push rods. You know, a lot of guys say, well, you know, how many times can I reuse my rocker arms or my lifters or my, you know, why are we only changing the valve springs? I mean, we have customers that adamantly change the lifters, push rods, and the valve springs and rocker arms, all of it.
Mm-hmm.
They change it all. They say it's not worth it because if it comes apart, it's done and I can sell the parts on eBay and get something back. And then at the end of the day, it's a good deal for me.
Well, let's tell you, I mean, all the Valtrain kind of wears in together too, right? So you don't really try not to just change part of it, right?
Right, right. Yeah. So I mean, the valve train, you know, is important to check out no matter what. You got to check the patient right before you operate. That's what I always say. But I mean, for example, you look at the end of a push rod, you know, they get shiny and then they start deforming, kind of like this one. You can see that there's a second groove here at the top, right? So when you take that motor apart, you could be telling a guy that you said it was 8,500. You can say, well, now it's 8,750. And he goes, why? Well, when we took your engine apart, we found this. And they're a little worn out. All the material's starting to come off and it's starting to work through the hardening. And that's a no-no for, you know, any marine high-performance engine. So usually we just quote it as if we're going to change all that. And then if we don't, then they get less of a bill.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's just safer to do that. But you know, basically, make sure you get the details of what it is, whether it's a drive rebuild, an engine rebuild, refresh, whatever someone wants to call it. You know, are they dynoing it? I mean, all ours include dyno, right? We don't add for that. It's part of our rebuild, right? Because we want to make sure it's not leaking and it's intact and ready to go. So when you drop it in, it's ready. But you know, is other people doing that? I don't know. You'd have to call around and find out what you get for what dollars and have these people done it before. How many? Can you get customers' names to talk to? I mean, there's a lot of ways you can see what it is that you're paying for.
Yeah, I mean, and that's a good question too. Is, I mean, you have a guy show up at your house, wants to sell you this to fix your house, do this and that, and you agree to go with them. Next thing you know, there's all these people show up and never the guy who sold you it. You know, a popular motor shop like yourself, you know, I think we talked about it. You do everything, but is that everybody? I mean, is everybody doing everything? Are they taking things out of house or?
Well, that's always a question mark. I mean, I mean, how much work does each rebuilder do themselves? I mean, we know of a lot of folks who they'll take the job and say they rebuild it and they sub the bottom ends to us. I mean, we don't mention their names because they're customers, but there's a lot of shops or gas stations or whatever, marinas, that they sell the rebuild and they basically send it to us and we send them from the cylinder heads back down and they put it on and they stand behind it. But most of those guys don't stand behind their own work. Yeah. A lot of them do, and that's why they're successful, because we could do the best job possible here, but they might not put the distributor in right on their end, and then all of a sudden the customer's going, well, what the heck? I mean, we've had it to where people have taken the job away from someone who we did the engine for, at least partially, and they screwed it up on the install, and they told us all about it, and we bit our tongue and just said, no problem, I'll fix it for you. Send it here, and it's going to be, you know, $3,000 or whatever it is.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of a bummer, but at the end of the day, you got to do what you got to do. I mean, you know, but a lot of the shops sub part of their work out. I mean, I don't know, I like to get my nose into every build we have here. Some of the other guys, you know, they say, oh yeah, I build the engines, but they don't, and they have a guy there doing it. I don't really know.
Yeah. And what about, I mean, as far as the people actually work on the motors themselves at a shop like yours, I mean, you know, obviously there's a lot that goes into it, but I mean, do you have just a key person that just actually gets their hands into the bottom end of it? I mean, is it, you train people, you know, what?
Well, I mean, me as the industry usually, you know, I don't know what everybody else does inside their, behind their closed doors. You know, they all say one thing and, you know, who knows what they're doing. It's not our business. But, you know, for us, like I said, I get involved in all the bottom ends. I'm the only one who does everything from the valve covers down. I mean, we have helpers here that assist handling. You know, it's like a surgery. Basically, our business here is like a surgery center.
That's a good point, yeah.
You know, I'm the surgeon. I come in, I do my operation, and then my guys button up the patient.
Yeah.
And then the surgeon comes in and says, okay, you're looking pretty good. You're not leaking. Everything looks tight. Let's check it again.
Yeah.
And then let's have him come back and visit the doctor in a week. We change the filter, check the oil. I mean, several of our customers can tell you we don't get charged for that. I mean, we just want to visit our clients. They've paid enough money usually. And we want to just, you know, for a filter for $20, we're going to charge them. For us, it's more like we want to see how our motor's doing. We cut the filter, take it apart, look for excess metal. I mean, there's always debris in the filters. It's just how much, you know? How's this motor living? Is it happy or unhappy? If it's unhappy, take it out.
Yeah.
See why it's unhappy. It could be a million different things, you know?
Yep.
You know, a lot of people don't realize, but when an engine breaks in, you have oil pump gears, they make metal-to-metal contact. You have a distributor and a cam that make metal-to-metal contact. Sometimes you have lifters that make metal-to-metal contact. And if you start your engine with not much oil in it, you could get a little bit of bearing thrust material in your, I mean, you shouldn't, but, you know, there's a lot of things. I mean, think about a dry sump motor with four stages.
Yeah.
That's like having four oil pumps in your motor. There's 2, 4, 6, 8, sometimes 10 gears spinning.
Yeah.
You're going to get trash in the oil.
Yeah.
You know, it's just hopefully it gets trapped and not in your bearings and ruins your day.
Yeah.
Because then you got to, you know, polish the crank, take it apart, which, I mean, this is what we do for a living, you know. So it's, for us, it's not abnormal.
Yeah.
But it's one of those deals where, you know, it's the old story. Find out what your rebuild is, what your builder's theory on their rebuild is. Do they even ask you if, you know, what it is that, you know, I mean, if they just shoot you a price without even mentioning that, you got to doubt that's, you're going to get the right deal.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, how much is a rebuild? Our answer here is, well, it typically costs $8,500 or more, but most of the bills are around $12,500.
Yeah.
That's how our guys are trained to tell people, because we're not going to lure you in like other folks may do or not. We don't sit there and see what other people are doing. We can only tell you what we do, but we do know that this happens at every level. I mean, go to a car dealership. I took my wife's Range Rover into the dealership, and they swore up and down they changed the oil and added fluid to the windshield washer.
I'd say that to you.
You know, this, that, and the other. And they told me all of it was done, and we took care of it because you're such a good customer. And da-da-da-da-da, this whole story. And I got it home, and I lifted the hood, and there was not 1 ounce of residue on the oil drain plug. the oil filter was still marked from the OEM. You know, they put a mark on it at Range Rover to see basically if it's been done yet, or, you know, a lot of those factory cars, they have markings on the original filters. You know, the windshield wiper fluid was empty. So basically what they did is they took my wife's really nice vehicle that I work hard for, and they just cleared the light. They plugged it in, cleared the light because they owed the oil change. They didn't want to do it. And then they sent it to us. So I ended up doing it myself, topping off all the fluids, checking it, and made the phone call and told them, you guys suck. You didn't do it, and it's provable. I'm not making it up.
Yeah.
So it's like, if something doesn't get done that you're owed, I mean, it happens in our marine industry too. I mean, you know, it's not, that stuff doesn't happen too often, but I was pretty bummed out about that. The bottom line is you need to know who you're dealing with, what you're getting for what you're paying for. It needs to be talked about.
Yeah.
And it needs to be over and over talked about. And then you got to make sure that you as a customer out there, you have to make sure that you're comfortable before you execute. Don't execute a deal with somebody unless you're comfortable.
Yeah.
You know, we speak with people all the time, and, you know, they've been burned by 10 people in whatever industry it might be, whether it's their house, their golf cart, their boat, their motorcycle. When they come to you, then you're the last person in the line that they're dealing with on that matter, and they come to you with a little different tone.
Yeah.
Because they've been through it. I mean, yeah. It happens with everything.
Yeah,
absolutely. So we always tell those clients, put yourself in our shoe. We're just here to help you.
Yeah.
You know, and if our reputation as a company is pretty good, then that has to have some value. And there's always a bad deal out there. Not every day is perfect. And I mean, we've had, you know, run-ins with customers, but we try to make good on it. But sometimes the attitudes don't allow it.
Yeah.
No matter what it is.
How about warranties? Like, you know, we talked a little bit about dry. You know, some companies say they advertise, okay, you have a one-year warranty as long as the horsepower is rated X and stuff. I mean, how is that stuff really regulated? I mean, it's...
Yeah, that's an interesting thing. I mean, warranty, right? Everybody that has a warranty, whether it's small company, big company, Home Depot product, you know, pick anything.
Yeah.
You know, what is a warranty? Well, it's only, first of all, it's only as good as the company that's telling you that they're giving you a warranty.
I thought you can tell me Tommy Boy version of that. Never
mind. No, no, but it's only as good as the company standing behind it.
Yeah.
I mean, some companies have written warranties that are called limited warranties. They're limited to if you use your boat, you can't get paid on any warranty.
Yeah.
If you read the small print. And some of them won't give you the small print until you execute a purchase. And then find out that if you actually start your boat and you don't warm it up for 12.2 minutes and put it in gear after that, and we're going to see that on your computer, then you have no warranty at all. Hmm. So I recommend reading what it is that you're committing to.
Yeah.
Doing the research about what you do before you buy it.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, some of the companies don't have a warranty.
Yeah.
They just have their honorable name.
Well, it's funny. I mean, I know I got a friend who has a very expensive motorcycle, and the computer was programmed that it would not go over a certain RPM. I mean, it literally took you through the stages of the breakthrough. But then I've heard other people that say, no, after something, you need to get that motor up to a certain RPM, you know, to let everything break in and
That's all whatever the manufacturer writes down and tells you to do or verbally tells you what to do. I would follow that.
So just because it's a combustion engine, it doesn't mean everything would be the same. It's different.
Right. It's not always the same. No, definitely not.
Yeah.
Clearances are different. Oils are different. Temperatures are different. So they're definitely not the same.
Yeah.
But what's interesting about it is going back to warranty. You know, you go to Home Depot, you buy something, you return it, they take it back. You buy something at, you know, company ABC or whatever it is, you bring it back. When you're dealing with something that's $50,000, like an average high-performance boat motor is going to cost you anymore, it gets a little weird. Yeah. I mean, are you buying a warranty? You know, I mean, I always used to sit here in our morning meetings and say, look, for 10 grand, I'll add it to any of the motor prices. I'll warranty it for 10 years for 10 grand.
Yeah.
That's $1,000 a year, and we would like to hope that our product is good enough.
Yeah.
Right? But it's just not reality. It prices you out of the market because there's not as much margin as you would think in some of these motors.
Yeah.
They're just expensive.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's one of those things like How do I explain it? So the warranty is only as good as the company or the individual standing behind it. How long the warranty is also up to that person.
Yeah.
But it's also up to you as clients out there on how you handle it and make the approach to redeem your warranty. I mean, you walk into the dealership and say, look, I spent a lot of money on this car and I couldn't get to work today. And because of you and your car, I can't live properly and I can't sleep at night. I mean, if you go in with that attitude, no matter what it is, I don't care what it, you're going to have less of a result than if you go and say, look, I understand this is a race car or a Corvette or one of our engines or whatever it is you're comparing this situation to. You kill someone with kindness, it might get them to do something for you.
Yeah.
I mean, I tend to give back whatever I can, and I feel bad for a client if he has any kind of a problem. I don't sleep at night thinking about it.
Yeah.
And then I say to myself, what can I do tomorrow morning to make our product not ever have this happen again?
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes I fail at it. I mean, you're trusting a vendor who's giving you a part.
Yeah.
And they tell you, just like, you know, anybody would tell you, oh, I'm going to make a change.
Yeah.
And they don't.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, all of a sudden you've tried, but you failed.
Yeah.
So it forces you to do, you know. So, look, you guys, just talk to your builders, whoever it is, whatever region you're in, and whatever support that you use for your, you know, everybody needs a local mechanic. I mean, you could buy our engine and ship it all over the world. They still need a guy or a company, female, male, whatever it is, to look at the engine once in a while. You got to go visit a doctor. Just because I put in your pacemaker doesn't mean that you have to come back to me for the rest of your life. I know you'd rather, and everybody usually tries to do that, but the fact is that you might move. You might go to Florida.
Sure.
So you might call your engine builder and say, look, I'd love to bring my boat all the way back to you to have a checkup on it, but who do you recommend now that I'm in the middle of nowhere? Wherever that might be, or we might be in the middle of nowhere and they're not.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it can be any which way. So, you know, always check with your builder how the break-in is supposed to be, the this, that, and the other. But, you know, when you warranty an engine, usually the warranty is for a new engine. Now, you mentioned rebuild.
Mm-hmm.
When you rebuild an engine and you give it to somebody, you must stand behind at least the workmanship of the rebuild. Okay? But if a part breaks...
Sure.
In a rebuild situation that wasn't changed. So example, say you do the valve, the whole valve train, the crankshaft, you don't do anything to, and the rods, you don't do anything, but you change the pistons, and the thing goes out and works for 2 weekends, all of a sudden the connecting rod blows in 10 pieces.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, yeah. It's just tired.
Yeah.
The metal fatigue or whatever it is, right? You know, what are you going to do in that? The guy's going to say, no, they're just going to blame the part. It wasn't the part. They probably left a bolt loose.
Mm-hmm.
You know, then they come in with that attitude that, no, it was you. It wasn't me because it's expensive.
Yeah.
So they always, then you got to, then now you have a personality conflict.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's one of those deals where you're pushing the blame, but you're not allowing the guy to even take it apart to tell you what it is or show you with his own hands.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? So that's where it gets weird. Warranties on rebuilt things gets weird. No matter who it is, what it is, it just gets weird.
Yeah.
You know, because if it's an unrelated part, I mean, in other words, you can't tell. I mean, if you're going to go through the process of X-raying every connecting rod and every crankshaft and every block during a rebuild, I would rather trade in your long block and sell you a brand new one. Therefore, we can stand behind it like a new motor.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's something that you guys have to think about when you're dealing with your provider. You know, I mean, these things do happen.
Yeah.
Now, if you took the motor out and the brand new valve train part broke, then usually we're going to have to take care of that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And we're going to go back to our vendor and say, hey, what's the deal? And usually they look at us and go, oh, no problem. We'll give you a valve. But the problem is that valve costs $4,000 to change.
Yeah.
So it's like, I wish they would turn around and say, we'll pay for labor and not the part.
Yeah.
They don't do any of it. So we get stuck as companies, and it's like anything else. You got to endure to stay in business. If not, close your doors.
Yeah.
A lot of guys have done it in the past.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, and it's not their fault. They might be a talented builder with a run of bad luck. We've all had it.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know... These are things to think about for you guys as far as rebuilds, refresh. You know, make sure that you're getting what you're paying for, and especially comparing what it is out there. I mean, for example, a 525 is the engine we picked. You know, is your provider putting the injectors on a machine and cleaning them? Because what good is it if you do all this work and you have a dirty fuel injector and you hurt the motor?
Yeah.
You know, or if it's the third rebuild, you better change the injectors. They get tired and worn out. They're like an electrical part. They'll stop working after a while, and they'll cost you a motor.
Yeah.
So, all right. So we've rambled on for about 30 minutes on a lot of topics tonight, and we have a lot more that we can go over for next week. We got a lot of questions in the last 2 weeks, and thanks for writing BoostPowerTV@BoostPower.com. And if you have any questions during or after the show, please feel to hit that up, BoostPowerTV@BoostPower.com. I'm Alexi Sahagi, and this is Jimmy Biro, and we will be back next week for more at Boost Power TV. Thanks again.